How's everyone doing?
We're
super glad to be here, and my partner and I were. I've been more on the business side of things. My partner is that I've been writing software with for the past 16 years. He's the CTO, so he's the one who can start talking about the fun monotonic shard keys and hot spotting servers and stuff like that. And you know, I'll be quick. So I'm not gonna bore you with Kager or anything like that. So, okay. So let's go to Python. Ah, that's what we're looking for. So, okay, company background. Who is Meterfeeder? Well, I'm Jim Gibbs, as I was saying before. This is live too, okay. I'm Jim Gibbs, CEO and co-founder of Meterfeeder, and Dan Lopretto, the CTO, and also co-founder, is with me as well. The best way to explain Meterfeeder is we enable local governments to accept credit card payments for parking without updating their infrastructure. So if you think about, how does that magic work? We just provide an Android device to the parking enforcement officer that normally just goes around. And if they see a meter that's expired, then they just check our enforcement app. If the person paid using Meterfeeder, the payment app, they just continue right along. Otherwise, directly from the enforcement app, they hit a button and write the person a ticket. There's definitely an old word or something. Yeah. Sorry, this is the wrong person for the presentation. I'll keep speaking in the meantime. So actually, the way that we started off, we were having lunch with a colleague of ours, and we went in to pitch in for lunch, and she pulled out a fistful of parking tickets, and she looked at us and said, if you guys make an app where we can pay for parking, I'd use it every day. And 2 weeks later, we entered the Object Rocket Rackspace NoSQL Challenge. And out of the hundreds of people who entered, we oddly enough ended up winning. Almost a year to the day, we ended up getting accepted to Y Combinator. So taking that money and that we won from Object Rocket and turning it into a scalable business is kind of what we're talking about today. So a little bit back on track. There are 4.5 million Coinbase meters in the United States. This was our original market. And these these municipalities that have these meters can't afford more digital solutions. So if you go outside and you see department enforcement officers walking around with those devices that look like the old TI-85 calculators. They actually lease those, the city leases those for about $9,000 a piece. So our Android device and rugged Bluetooth printer and stuff like that, we can come in at about a tenth of the cost. So and each one of these meters, on average, we make about $40 to $50 per meter. So we could definitely create a big business out of this. So how do we get to 100% of that 4.5 million meters? Make something that people want. So when we got the first client, we just kept iterating and iterating. We didn't really know what they wanted, so we just figured we might as well talk to them and they will give us the answers because they wanted to work as much as we wanted to work. So we kept on doing that until they loved it. We kept talking to the people who were paying until they loved it. And then we spoke to client number two. And they liked our solution, didn't love our solution, because they were like, hey, we love the payment, we love the enforcement, but we want to do more things with tickets. We want to do more interesting things with tickets and online ticket payment and how they handle their current tickets. So we helped them out. You know, had to change our data structure a little bit, and they ended up loving it. So we went to the third client, and again, the third client just liked our solution. They loved the payment, they loved the enforcement, they loved the tickets, but then they had these multi-space meters, these kiosks that we had to integrate with. They we notice that everyone in the industry happens to use soap for some strange reason, so I mean, it's a little bit sad, but we were able to take care of that, and we moved on to our fourth client, who, oddly enough, actually just loved our solution. So we just went on to the number five, and they liked our solution, but although they loved our payment, they loved the enforcement, they loved the tickets, and they were glad that we integrated with another kiosk, but they had another kiosk vendor. So we had to do yet another integration. So yeah, we're growing at 10% week over week. So it's kind of important that these integrations happen quickly. We have to, in order to keep that growth up, we need to continue to talk to bigger cities, and you know, every integration deals with different information. So, you know, one person might want to capture one data. They might, they want to hear from us certain data. You guys get the basic idea. So, everyone's trying to get into the futurization of cities business. It's a $1.7 trillion industry. So, you have companies like AT&T and Sidewalk Labs. They're owned by Alphabet. No one really knows what that means, like, to be honest. The Department of Transportation actually just had the Smart Cities competition. Columbus, Ohio won, and they ended up getting $40 million to define what a smart city is. So again, when we started this business, we didn't really know collectively what we were getting into, like what kind of data we were going to need to capture. And even now, when we get into the futurization of cities, how are we going to know what data to capture when it's not even properly defined? So, yeah, again, we don't know all the answers. Whether we go for coins, integrations, futurization, connected world, Internet of Things. But yeah, that is the key. We need to make sure that our database is as flexible as possible so that, you know, once we do have the answers, we could just hurry up, swing back around, and create another solution. So with that being said, I'm going to introduce my good friend Dan, and CTO and co-founder.
Thank you. Yeah, sure. You can hold on to that. Okay. So yeah, so I'm going to talk about, so Jim set up the problem, right? There's all of these, there's this Internet of Things, and there's this data that we are getting as a company from all of these different places, all of these different vendors, from vehicles to smartphones to smartwatches. These are all different sources, and I think that a lot of, we've already heard from many companies today that are moving in these same directions, where they're starting to pull data in from many different sources. So you know, our API, we try to do predictive analysis of where vehicles are parked or where they're going to park. We get data from parking lots, from garages, from street meters. We also collect payments, so we have things coming in from Stripe, Google Wallet, Apple Pay, Bitcoin, PayPal. And all this data comes in, and we're trying to stick it in into one database. Similar ways that an e-commerce website is going to take reviews and recommendations, loyalty programs, all this different information about products isn't going to be in the same structure. It's not going to fit very nicely into the tables that they have, that they've created into their schema. So how can a small startup, you know, two developers, a couple of salespeople and account managers, how can we, you know, it can feel like shifting sand. With the small startup trying to build for all of these different vendors. So, you know, in a traditional structured tables, it makes innovation very difficult. But what do you do with all that data you're getting in from those vendors that doesn't fit nice and neatly into your SQL table? You see, we just keep branching out and making more migrations and more ways, shoehorning more ways to put data into our tables, or we can just dump it into MongoDB. So we went with the second option. Our non-structured MongoDB collections, and then we make these lightweight modules to normalize that data, and it still makes all of that, that cross-channel information very searchable. It's, it can be indexed. And I want to go into more of a concrete example of exactly what I'm talking about here. So we have payment platforms, and Jim was talking about how there's different vendors, and every time we call up a city and they say, we love what you're doing, but we use this vendor that you don't support, so we can't do it. Well, no, hold on, we can take care of that. So you I'm sure you've seen, as Jim was talking about, if you go outside actually, you can see these payment kiosks where you walk up and you punch in your license plate information, swipe your credit card. The machine then uses the cellular network to send the information back to whoever owns that kiosk. So we can call them. So we've got one product, which is payments, and then Meter Feeder itself makes app payments, and then we've got two different vendors, or we'll call those Acme meters and XYZ meters. So we need to get the data from those meters, from the vendors back in so that it can be used through our system. So how we do that is a very, very bare bones example of what our API servers looks like right now. We have our UI fetches data from our API, and we keep our MongoDB as an object rocket, and then we also have the ability to go out and ask the XYZ API and the Acme API if they know anything. So for example, if this is a parking enforcement officer, a meter maid, looking up a license plate, it's going to ask all three of these services that are connected in that city all at the same time. We use pretty pretty tight timeouts on these, and also if anyone responds, as soon as we get a response back, we go ahead and send that back to the UI. We don't wait for everybody to respond before we send that message back. That's an important part. But when those messages do come back, if we do get any positives, we cache those back into our database. So the speed and making sure that we stay the fastest means that usually our latency is based on how fast we can ask Object Rocket about the data, which is a lot better than how fast we can ask some these other vendors who may not be as sophisticated. So that's one of the really important parts of caching and kind of using the system like this. So I'll go into kind of how we can structure that data in our collections and our documents. This is like really what I call like the base model of the collection. So these are the pieces of data that we will normalize when we're putting data into a document. So we've got a zone, which is an object ID, and that's a reference to another collection that has, basically that's the geospatial data for where that parking transaction transpired. So it could be like a block of city streets or a small neighborhood. Those usually qualify a zone. And we've got information about the vehicle that we need, and then a start and an end date. The reason that we normalize just this data is this is really the data that we want to build our indexes on. These are, in the most cases, this is the information. When someone started and ended their parking session, and information about their vehicle and where it was parked are how we're going to create our indexes. An interesting point about when I show this to people is I get questions about the fact that I've kind of mixed two one-to-many relations. Like so I have a zone, which is a one-to-many relation, and I use that really it's an external reference that we'll hydrate the data back into, and then but the vehicle, we keep the vehicle separate for each document, and I get questions about that, and really I like to think of it as what the context is that I want to know about that data. And so if we know more, so let's say this is a parking ticket, for example, we know a lot more information about this data. We know not only the license plate number and the state, but maybe we also know the make and model. We may know some information about the driver and what color it is, you know, items like that. That item can change from ticket to ticket. Like the person could get a new car, or the car could be sold and the license plate changed on the vehicle. So the context around that data is very centric to this document, whereas if the data in the zone changes, I would want that to hydrate back. So if the zone changes, if the geometry of the zone changes, or maybe the customer or client wants to change the name of the zone from, you know, Dormont Borough to the Borough of Dormont, the ability to change that, and it hydrates across or gets updated really across all documents. So kind of the ideas, the explanation behind that. Here and then, so actually before, how we have different objects that represent different types of data in the same collection, you see that our meter feeder app payments, the top block is still the same. We still have the zone, vehicle, start, and end time, because it's the data that we're going to index. Then at the bottom, the important thing to note is the __T, which is set to meter feeder payments. So that's the discriminator that we use back in our ORM layer to discriminate what kind of object we want to map this into. They all will inherit from the base model, from the parent, the payments, but they're going to have different characteristics based on whether we got them from a kiosk vendor or they were populated by our own software. And then everything else that we get, almost really everything else that we get, unless it's complete garbage that we have to throw away, we put into the data object. and then you see here's just another example of data that we would get from the Acme API XML feed, which, as Jim said before, usually a SOAP request. And you can see that in the discriminator here, I try to be very verbose on those. We have had instances amongst two cities that use the same piece of hardware, but they're different physical versions of that hardware. Their APIs actually will look different. They have some similar characteristics, but that it's kind of a mess between different formats. So we end up jumping through a lot of hoops. And also, another good reason to take all this external data and shove it into really a sub field or sub document here, this is the sub object, is because you're at that point you're really dealing with someone else's coding standard. You're dealing with the way someone else wants the data to look. You can see here, there's an example, if you guys can see this in the back. The way that we store the start and end date are just as ISO dates, and the way that we get the data from the vendor is we get the date that was created, that's the start, and then we get the time zone that string is actually in. Awesome enough. And then we get a number, which is the length, the number of minutes that person has paid for parking. So it'd be like, you know, a date and time in the Eastern Standard time zone, and then 60 minutes, and we know that. So we need to coerce that data into our start and end times. So after we get all these pieces of data, we create, this is really a growing project as we integrate with more and more vendors. This list gets larger and larger. So we've got our abstract class. So this is This is our object to document mapping. So we've got our objects in our software, and we've got our documents in our collection. And these are the actual classes that we will use to map those together. So we start off with our abstract payments object, and then we've got meter feeder payments, we've got Acme meter payments, and we've got XYZ meter payments. And then off of Acme, we've got version 1, version 2, and version 3 of their hardware. So the system does kind of balloon out, but it's all really it's all really a system based on, you know, polymorphism and object-oriented programming. So it's easy to organize. So just to stay platform agnostic, I tried not to make this look like any one specific programming language. Under the hood, we use Node.js, and so also Mongoose. And that's some really great stuff for us, allowing us to populate reference documents. A simple Mongoose also has methods for adding on methods and statics and virtuals. But just to show, you know, in a very generic way, we have an abstract class. We define specifically on this abstract class what the collection is called instead of using any type of reflection. That's so when we inherit from different classes that have different names, it knows to always take this data and go back to the payments collection. And then we have the properties defined that are going to be normalized across our data. And then we have a static that we put in to all these base classes, and really it gets overridden in some of the child classes. And what the transform does is it takes that raw data JSON blob, the key values from the document, and it wraps that into this class and returns a new instance of the class. And then this is some examples of what we would have for our meter feeder payments, which extends payments. It's our data, so we get to be a little pickier about how we organize it. So getting the date is easy. We just return the date property. But this, in for the vendors, for any integrations we do, so for Acme meter payments, this is our normalization. So normalization happens in getters. It doesn't happen in the setters. And you can see for the same as I was talking about before, there's a lot more steps to go through to get the data, to get the end date. But we're not throwing away all of that intermediary data. It all still exists in the database, and it therefore is still searchable and still used to power innovation. Final thing that I have an example here is we will override the find static from the MongoDB implementation. And what we do when it's overridden is we use that then to go and make requests from that remote vendor's API. And then when those requests come back, then we'll do the caching and let them respond. So that happens kind of asynchronously. So just to talk about a few of the takeaways of what Jim and I talked about. You're gonna, to make great products that people love, you need to be flexible enough to work with other vendors. And to do that, objects in your software should give form to what's in your database. I think that this used to be really common in software development, but we've seen a shift from development teams getting smaller, development teams especially becoming more agile. Their software has become more tightly coupled with what's in the database, especially in structured data. And the best way to decouple that, to break the coupling, is to avoid letting documents impose their structure on your software. So that's really all I have for you today, and I'll take any questions that you have. Yes, please.
So you're keeping the foreign transaction on your document.
The foreign transaction?
So this was the start time, what zone it is,
yeah.
How many minutes. You keep that whole thing, and then you also calculate start in it, and keep that in document.
So the question was, we keep all of the inputs of the transaction, and then we calculate and keep those in the document as well. And yes, we do. Like I said, the items that we're calculating and storing, those are the ones that we want to create our indexes on. So it's specific to just where we want to have our indexes at. The rest of the data we do not do any transformation on before we insert it into the table. Well, thank you all very much. Appreciate talking to you today.